Namaste, angels. I'm here this morning to talk to you about St. Andrew's Cross. So the other day while I was on jury duty, the first day I walked by, I told you I looked at one of the statues of St. Andrew and I had this revelation that I couldn't remember exactly how it started, but it led to what God meant about coveting. The next day, I was walking down that same path past St. Andrew's Church, and I looked up again and I saw a different statue, and it was a statue of St. Andrew holding this X shape in front of him. And I'm going, St. Andrew, X shape, what X? And I'm trying to remember like what this is about. Picture what this is about, and I'm thinking St. Elmo's fire, and I'm like, no, that's St. Elmo, that's not St. Andrew, like, what am I doing? And I'm like racking my brain. I keep walking, I see another statue there, so I don't know why I didn't see either of these the first day, or why I've never really noticed them before in all the times that I've passed St. Andrew's. See another one, like a brass one maybe, ground level, like in a small garden, and he's got this X again. So now I get to jury duty, I have to look up what is this X, or else it's going to drive me nuts. One of the first things that comes up, or perhaps the first thing to come up, is this BDSM thing, which is disgusting. I didn't even click on that. And I'm like, why would that be the first thing associated with St. Andrew? But this is what they do. This is what they do. The same way, you know, for example, terrorism is associated with the name ISIS. That's the first thing you think of, rather than the goddess, which should be the first thing you think of. The first thing they have in the Google search for St. Andrew's Cross is this thing for, you know, masochists, sexual deviants, basically. And I didn't check again to see what they use it for. I don't even want to know. Not my business, not my place to judge, but I didn't feel positive about clicking on it, so I did not. Anyway, I then clicked on the Wikipedia. Actually, that's happening today. That day, I clicked on something much more informative. And again, it was right when I got there. Like, I had no time to waste. I had to look up right away. I was still online, actually, to get inside the courthouse. And I'm reading this stuff about St. Andrew. And since then, I've had to talk to you about it. So I'm going to do that right now. But I don't see the same site that I was on. So I'm using a different one. This is www.seiyaku, SEIYAKU.com, and this is /custom/crosses/Andrew. St. Andrew's Cross, a remarkable lesson in Stoicism, STOICISM. St. Andrew's Cross, also called a saltire, SALTIRE. It is believed that the Apostle St. Andrew was crucified on a saltire, X-shaped cross, hence the name St. Andrew's Cross. He is said to have told his executioners that he was not worthy to be crucified on the same cross style as Jesus, and persuaded them to alter the shape. If this is true, it's a remarkable example of Stoicism displayed by a man, no doubt beaten and starved, yet retaining the mental energy to plead such a thing with his brutal executioners. Detailed records of his crucifixion only date back to the Middle Ages, and these records are influenced by the imagination of the medieval artists. But even if the origin is a myth, the cross shape reminds Christians that they should exercise humility. In Greek, the first letter for Christ, in parentheses, they have C-H-I, so like Chi, or like Chi-Town, like Chicago, also happens to be X-shaped, as in the Chi Rho cross. Okay, so C-H-I is a letter, in the Greek alphabet. And I guess so is RHO. Instead of simply saying that something is X-shaped or saltire, the term St. Andrew's Cross is used for several terms that have absolutely nothing to do with St. Andrew or even religion. For example, there's an Argiope, A-R-G-I-O-P-E, and another word I'm not even going to try to pronounce right now, Kyerslingy, K-I-Y-S-E-R-L-I-N-G-I, and the Aragope Mangal, M-A-N-G-A-L, a tiny brightly striped spider found in the mangroves of Singapore. These are commonly known as St. Andrew spiders because they hold their eight legs in pairs, forming an X shape. Then there's the Hypericum, H-Y-P-E-R-C-U-M, Hyperichoides, H-Y-P-E-R-I-C-O-I-D-E-S, a small shrub of the St. John's wort family. Its flowers form a cross with four yellow petals and is known as St. Andrew's cross. The saltire, S-A-L-T-I-R-E, is seen on the USA's Confederate flag, showing the Scottish lineage of many Southerners. It was not the official flag of the Confederate States, but is nevertheless widely referred to as the Confederate flag. On this flag, the saltire is known as the Southern Cross. And that's a hyperlink, so I'll click and see what that says. Southern Cross is the most familiar constellation in the Southern Hemisphere. There are an unknown number of stars in the constellation, but the four brightest form the tips of a cross. The bottom star, Alpha Crucis, C-R-U-C-I-S, is a binary star with both considerably larger than the sun. To the left is a blue-white star, Mimosa, or Beta Crucis, C-R-U-C-I-S, the brightest of the group, and almost five times the size of the sun. At the top is Gamma Crucis, and the right is Delta Crucis. Somewhere between Alpha Crucis and Delta Crucis is a smaller star known as Epsilon Crucis. And it looks kind of like north, south, east, and west, but with the middle line being longer. They have a Y at the top, an A at the bottom, a B at the left, and a S, I guess, to your right. It's a snake-shaped kind of thing. I'm not sure what this is. Maybe it's a D for Delta. I'll see if I can get a picture of it and include it. Top, bottom, left, right, relative size and brightness are only as we see them from Earth. And of course, the orientation depends on your position on Earth. Get a bit closer and you'll see a world of difference. The constellation is a long way away. Acrux, A-C-R-U-X, for example, is 1.8 billion 9 miles from Earth, 325 light years. Becrux, B-E-C-R-U-X, is even further at 580 light years, 13. The fact that they are visible to the naked eye shows just how bright these stars are. They can be seen these days only in the southern hemisphere at latitudes north of 25 degrees 7, but 7,000 years ago, they would have been visible in Britain. The Greeks revered them, and 2,000 years ago, and could just, I think they have an extra and in there by accident, could just about see them on the horizon. In the 17th century, the stars were useful nighttime navigation points. Well, they did just remind me of north, south, east, and west, for mariners and explorers, following an imaginary line defined by the top and bottom two stars for approximately 4.5 times the distance between them leads to the South Pole, 9. Unless it's cloudy. Orion. Oh, maybe this is why I was supposed to read this, because of course Orion is Osiris. Orion, also slowly moving south from the celestial equator, is the Orion constellation, which has a similar pattern as the Southern Cross, with an additional bright star in the center. These five stars have had many mythical interpretations in the past, and today the pattern is printed in semi-secret positions on many of the world's banknotes. This is to hinder scanning them to make counterfeit money. The hardware industry refers to this pattern as your ion, like the euro, E-U-R-I-O-N, a portmanteau. We learned that word the other day, which is like a, now I forget the American, the English word for it, but a conjunction like, of Euro and Orion. So in the past, where Orion was named after the Greek god of hunting and known as various gods by different civilizations, but I'm going back to the first one, Kemet and Egypt, it is now named in honor of the god of money. And let me click and see who they say that is, because Orion is Osiris. I don't know who this god of money is. God of money. Once upon a time in a village, a man appeared and announced to the villagers that he would buy monkeys for $10 each. The villagers, seeing that there were many monkeys around, went out to the forest and started catching them. The man bought thousands at $10. And as supplies started to diminish, the villagers stopped their effort. He further announced that he would now buy at $20. This renewed the efforts of the villagers, and they started catching monkeys again. Soon, the supply diminished even further, and people started going back to their farms. The offer increased to $25 each, and the supply of monkeys became so little that it was an effort to even see a monkey, let alone catch it. The man now announced that he would buy monkeys at $50. However, since he had to go to the city on some business, his assistant would now buy on behalf of him. In the absence of the man, the assistant told the villagers, "Look at all these monkeys in the big cage that the man has collected. I will sell them to you at $35. And when the man returns from the city, you can sell them to him for $50. The villagers rounded up all their savings and bought all the monkeys. Then they never saw the man or his assistant again, only monkeys everywhere. Now you have a better understanding of how the stock market works." Oh, okay, so that was a joke. And it goes on to say, just say yes with, like, I'm going to have to take a picture of this and show you. It's not a regular Y or E or S. It's like financial symbols. For the god of money, aka the god of greed and the god of power, its symbols are usually regional. They include all major currencies. In the case of lower deities such as sex, tobacco, alcohol, and other drugs, religious zeal can become addictive, but for money, there is no can. Addiction is certain. Other features of the religion include adherence. Investors come from all walks of life. There is no discrimination on the basis of sex, socioeconomic banding, income, health, or affiliations to other religions. There are various sects, such as Church of Savings and the complementary Church of Credit. The god of money even has its own cross, Orion. The prophets, stock exchange dealers, priests, bankers, and their deacons, financial advisors, preach through the good book, internet, magazines, and newspaper articles, extolling, E-X-T-O-L-L-I-N-G, the virtues of good works, risk, forgiveness, and love are lacking for believers and true followers. Progress is considered synonymous with good, without stopping to think what progress means. Although irrational, it is by far the most popular and widespread religion in the world, much more popular than rational religions such as Christianity and Islam, for the love of money is the root of all evil. 1 Timothy 6:10, 6:10 is D's birthday, and he is violent in his love of wealth. Quran 108:8. The Quran is not a hyperlink, but this Timothy 6 is. The first epistle of Paul the Apostle to Timothy, chapter 6, New English Translation. Those who are under the yoke as slaves must regard their own masters as deserving of full respect. This will prevent the name of God and Christian teaching from being discredited. But those who have believing masters must not show them less respect because they are brothers. Instead, they are to serve all the more because those who benefit from their service are believers and dearly loved. Teach them and exhort them about these things. If someone spreads false teachings and does not agree with sound words, that is, those of our Lord Jesus Christ, and with the teachings that accords with godliness, he is conceited and understands nothing, but has an unhealthy interest in controversies and verbal disputes. This gives rise to envy, dissension, slanders, evil suspicions, and constant bickering by people corrupted in their minds and deprived of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a way of making a profit. Now, godliness combined with contentment brings great profit, for we have brought nothing into this world, and so we can take a single thing out either. But if we have food and shelter, we will be satisfied with that. Those who long to be rich, however, stumble into temptation and trap and many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all evils. Some people, in reaching for it, have strayed from the faith and stabbed themselves with many pains. But you, as a person dedicated to God, keep away from all that. Instead, pursue righteousness, godliness, faithfulness, love, endurance, and gentleness. I mean, I could go on. I already finished the 6:10, though, that we were being directed to. Let's see. I might as well read it. Complete well for the faith and lay hold that eternal life you were called for and made your good confession, for in the presence of many witnesses. Charge you before God, who gives life to all things, in Christ Jesus, who made his good confession before Pontius Pilate, to obey this command without fault or failure until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is soon, whose appearing the blessed and the only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, will reveal at the right time. He alone possesses immortality and lives in unapproachable light, whom no human has ever seen or is able to see. To him be honor and eternal power. Amen. Command those who are rich in this world's goods not to be haughty or to set their hopes on riches, which are uncertain, but on God, who richly provides us with all things for our enjoyment. Tell them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, to be generous givers, sharing with others. In this way, they will save up a treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the future, and so lay hold of what is truly life. O Timothy, protect what has been entrusted to you. Avoid the profane chatter and absurdities of so-called knowledge. By professing it, some have strayed from faith. Grace be with you all. So this is talking about people who distort the message, who are only in, you know, this quote-unquote business to make money, not to save souls, not to help twin flames unite, reunite, with the ultimate goal being to save the world, just to you know, layer and fatten their pockets. But like they said, you can't take it with you. And if I'm correct that there's only 5 years left to this place that we know as Earth, the one we know as Earth currently, they're not going to have much use for what they're stealing, and they won't be here. If there is a way to spend money they won't be here to spend it, those people. And that's not my word. That's not my threat against anyone or wish for anyone. That's basically just what we read and have been reading. Well, I didn't mean to close St. Andrew, though. Well, I'll read this other one for now, which is from Wikipedia. St. Andrew's Cross, or Andrew's Cross, may refer to a saltire, X-shaped cross in heraldry and vexillology, V-E-X-I-L-I-O-L-O-G-Y. St. Andrew's Cross usually refers to the following specific flags: the flag of Scotland, white saltire on blue field; flag of Alabama, red saltire on white field; the flag of, and Alabama is where the story I was talking, I began to speak about, and I said I would talk about at length later, where the young man was killed when they just were looking for any black person to kill, black male to kill. That happened in Alabama. Again, 1981, not a million years ago, you know, for everybody that says, oh, this stuff is over, you know, and it's really not only incorrect, but wrong on all subtle levels. For anybody, I mean, now we know that so-called white people are black, with the exception of these mutations that are supposedly the quote-unquote pure, or at least call themselves that. But for anybody who is not a so-called Negro, you know, black as we have known it until now, to say things like this is over, you know, slavery is over, or racism is over, is so far beyond wrong. It's like completely reprehensible, disrespectful, but just incorrect, flat out incorrect. Anyway, the battle flag of Forest Cavalry Corps, blue and white saltire on a red field. I feel like I should look and see what that is. The flag of New Spain, the cross of Burgundy, the Russian Navy ensign, E-N-S-I-G-N, is a blue saltire on a white field. St. Andrew's Cross, an otherwise blank area on a sheet of stamps, which is printed with a cross. St. Andrew's Cross in BDSM, an X-shaped cross in BDSM dungeons. I don't even know why they have this again listed here like this, but at least it's not first this time. Argiope, spider, the St. Andrew's Cross spider. St. Andrew's Cross, a street junction in Plymouth, the United Kingdom. And I feel like I should go over Plymouth as well. Hypericum, Hypericotes, flowering plant commonly called St. Andrew's Cross. Andrew Cross Award for UK religious journalism. The cross buck at level crossings. Okay, I'm going to go back up for a second to Forest, F-O-R-R-E-S-T, Cavalry Corps. The Forest Cavalry Corps was part of the Confederate States Army. I knew I was supposed to look at this. During the American Civil War, and commanded by Lieutenant General Nathan Bedford Forrest, formed during the summer of 1862, it took part in the various battles in the Western Theater during the second half of the war. What's this being called, a Western Theater? The Western Theater of the American Civil War encompassed major military operations in the states of Alabama, Georgia, Florida, Mississippi, North Carolina, Kentucky, South Carolina, and Tennessee, as well as Louisiana east of the Mississippi River. Operations on the coast of the states, except for Mobile Bay, are considered part of the Lower Seaboard Theater. I wonder if this has anything to do with the lowrider. All my friends know the lowrider. Mobile Bay is an inlet of the Gulf of Mexico lying within the state of Alabama in the United States. Its mouth is formed by the Fort Morgan, M-O-R-G-A-N, peninsula on the eastern side of Dauphin Island, D-A-U-P-H-I-N, a barrier island on the western side. The Mobile River and Tensaw River, T-E-N-S-A-W, empty into the northern end of the bay, making it an estuary. Several smaller rivers also empty into the bay, Dog River, Deer River, and Fowl River, as in like bird, fowl, on the western side of the bay, and Fish River on the eastern side. The eastern side would be Osiris's side, Fish. I wonder if that's a link. Mobile Bay is the fourth largest estuary in the United States with a discharge of 62,000, so another 8 cubic feet or 1,800 meters, I guess, cubed. It says M3. Well, 1,800 is 9 of water per second. Oh, this is a measurement of liquid. I'm not familiar. M3. Anyway, annually and often several times during the summer months, the fish and crustaceans will swarm the shallow coastline and shore of the bay. This event, appropriately named a jubilee, draws a large crowd because of the abundance of fresh, easily caught seafoods it yields. Mobile Bay is the only place on Earth where jubilees are a common occurrence. Mobile Bay is 413, so that's another 8 square miles, or 1,070 kilometers squared, that's still 8 in area. It is 31 miles or 50 kilometers long by a maximum width of 24 miles or 39 kilometers. The deepest areas of the bay are located within the shipping channel, sometimes in excess of 75 feet deep, but the average depth of the bay is 10 feet or 3 meters. And I was thinking when they had me do, what's that song by Jay-Z and Kanye? Oh, Niggas in Paris. And that shit cray. I was thinking about crayfish and what some people call crawfish and what some people further call crawdads, depending upon how country you are. And I don't remember what I had tied that into, because it's been, I think, about a month or so, maybe longer, since I've had to do that song. But now I'm thinking about it again with mention of these crustaceans coming up on land, like in large numbers. I'm going back. I'm going to have to go over, I guess, the Dauphin Island and all this kind of stuff. I mean, there's so much here. It's going to have to be separate videos. But going back to Forrest Cavalry Corps, it was part of the Confederate States Army during the American Civil War, and was commanded by Lieutenant General Nathan Bedford Forrest. Formed during the summer of 1862, it took part in the various battles in the Western Theater during the second half of the war, at first serving as part of the Army of Tennessee. Both Forrest and the Corps were then transferred to Northern Mississippi and often launched independent raids into Union-occupied Western and Central Tennessee. I think I'm going to come back and go further into this. Or should I just do it now on one long one? All right, I'll go on. There's just so much here. I'm looking at this. I'm like, oh, goodness. Like, where to even begin? There's so many hyperlinks and everything. Well, the history of this war or battle. In May 1863, or 9-9, which today is also 9-9-72-2016 when I'm recording this, is 9-9. Nathan Bedford Forrest was given the cavalry command of Earl Van Dorn, who had recently been murdered. The corps initially consisted of divisions of William H. Jackson and Frank C. Armstrong, but Jackson's division was soon sent to Mississippi, leaving Forrest with only Armstrong's division. On September 3rd, Braxton Bragg, commander of the Army of Tennessee, gave Forrest the division of John Pegram and placed him in command of the cavalry of north of Chattanooga. During the early stages of the Chickamauga, Chickamauga campaign, and I gotta see what that is, otherwise we don't know what we're talking about. The Chickamauga campaign of the American Civil War was a series of battles fought in northwestern Georgia from August 21st to September 20th, 1863. Again, 9-9, that was the year at least, between the Union Army of the Cumberland and the Confederate Army of Tennessee. The campaign started successfully for Union Commander William S. Rosecrans, R-O-S-E-C-R-A-N-S, with the Union Army occupying the vital city of Chattanooga and forcing the Confederates to retreat into northern Georgia. But a Confederate attack at the Battle of Chickamauga forced Rosecrans to retreat back into Chattanooga and allowed the Confederates to lay siege to Union forces. So they won this battle, apparently, it sounds, or at least that portion of the battle, but we know who won the war, ultimately. Similar to what we're experiencing now. You know, sometimes the darker energies win small battles, and we know who is to win the war here, this final war. So where was I with regard to history of this? Chickamauga, where did I click on that? During the early stages of the Chickamauga campaign, Forrest's Corps served on the Army's right as a rear guard during the retreat from Chattanooga, while Forrest himself was wounded during the fighting. The Corps covered the right flank of D.H. Hill's Corps during the Battle of Chickamauga, earning praise from Hill. On the morning of September 21st, following the Confederate victory in the battle, Forrest rode toward Chattanooga with 400 men and found that the Union Army was still in chaos. He urged Bragg, B-R-A-G-G, I guess of Fort Bragg, North Carolina, to attack the city immediately, but Bragg instead settled in for a siege of the Union garrison. And I don't know why garrison is in with a lowercase g, but it is. Okay, and we can go on and read more about the Battle of Forrest or Forrest Cavalry Corps, what I came to talk about. I'm going back to St. Andrew's Cross, but I will click on some of these things that are related. For example, I said I felt like I should also click on Plymouth, because, again, so-called Independence Day, or at least from the universe's perspective, as it has been shown to me, is about freedom. And as it has been shown to all of us, rather, because the cards keep coming up, freedom, freedom, freedom. I mean, I didn't make that up. You guys saw it yourselves with your own eyes, too, in addition to what I was told, that this has to do with freedom and the fact that we are not free. So we should stop calling it Independence Day. And this is, again, not me. This is what I'm being shown by the universe, the powers that be, the powers, the beings, the highest beings of light. So I'm going to read this part. St. Andrew's Cross, a street junction in Plymouth, United Kingdom. I'm clicking on Plymouth right now. This article is about the city in the United Kingdom. For the Massachusetts town, see Plymouth, Massachusetts. For the car brand, see Plymouth Automobile. For other uses, see Plymouth. Okay. Plymouth, so again, in the United Kingdom, is a city on the south coast of Devon, D-E-V-O-N, England, about 37 miles southwest of Exeter, E-X-E-T-E-R, and 190 miles west-southwest of London, between the mouths of the rivers Plym, P-L-Y-M, to the east, and Tamar, T-A-M-A-R, to the west, where they join Plymouth Sound to form the boundary with Cornwall. Now, I was talking about Cornwall the other day. I was going, Cornwall, that was something, and I don't remember what I ever decided it was. I remember I also started talking about Stonewall, and I never mentioned that days later, the president declared the Stonewall Hotel here, like the first, like LGBT landmark, you know, federal, like landmark, so to speak, memorial, in the country, here in New York, in the Village. So maybe that's why I was going on about Stonewall. And I didn't know it. Anyway, where was I? Plymouth's early history extends to the Bronze Age, when a first settlement emerged at Mount Badon. Something else about this Devon. I'm pretty sure that this is a place where I had read, about which I had read, where a gentleman had allegedly murdered this woman, and they kept trying to put him to death for it. He kept escaping, like El Chapo style, and they couldn't, they tried like three times to kill this man, and they could not. He kept like disappearing. I'm pretty sure it was Devon. I was reading about a couple months ago, and never did anything with that either. I gotta look it up. Or you guys can look it up now that I've said it. You know, maybe you find something on this. It was pretty interesting what I was reading. Anyway, this settlement continued as a trading post for the Roman Empire until it was surpassed by the more prosperous village of Sutton, S-U-T-T-O-N, now called Plymouth, in 1620. I'm sorry, in 1620, the Pilgrim Fathers departed Plymouth. You see, here we go. This is how it relates. The Pilgrim Fathers departed Plymouth for the New World and established Plymouth Colony, the second English settlement in what is now the United States of America. During the English Civil War, the town was held by the Parliamentarians and was besieged between 1642 and 1646. So they just sort of quickly, you know, like brush over that. The Pilgrims or Pilgrim Fathers were early European settlers of the Plymouth County in present-day Plymouth, Massachusetts, United States. The Plymouth leadership came from the religious congregations of the Brownist, B-R-O-W-N-I-S-T, English dissenters. So these were people escaping religious persecution who came over here and persecuted a bunch of other people. Racial persecution, religious persecution, every kind of persecution they could think of. They came over here and did that. Nice. Of course, I'm being sarcastic. Who had fled the volatile political environment of England for the relative calm and tolerance of 16th to 17th century Holland and the Netherlands. The Pilgrims held Calvinist religious beliefs similar to the Puritans, but unlike many Puritans, maintained that their congregations needed to be separated from the English state church. As a separatist group, they were also concerned that they might lose their English cultural identity if they immigrated to the Netherlands. So they arranged with English investors to establish a new colony in North America. Oh, that was nice. The colony was established in 1620 and became the second successful English settlement in North America after the founding of Jamestown, Virginia in 1607. So that was the first. The Pilgrim's story of seeking religious freedom has become a central theme of history and culture of the United States. By this time, non-English European colonization of the Americas was also underway in New Netherland, New France, Essequibo, Essequibo, Colonel Brazil, Barbados, the Vice Royalty of Peru, and New Spain. And these are all places we could click on. I mean, these are all hyperlinks. I mean, I could be talking for days about this. I'm trying to get to, I mean, it's all relative, I'm sure. I'm trying to get to the most notable parts of how our freedom has been stolen. You know, pirates, yes, they rabbi from the merchant ships. I'm trying to get to that. And to the connection to St. Andrew and how he is someone else who died for our freedom and how Spirit wants us to release our ex. Again, he already did the dying on our behalf. The least we can do is to release the ex and speak out and stand up against wrongs, against the denial of civil rights, against things we know to be false. We know to be falsehoods. We're supposed to stand up and say, that's not right. What you're doing, what you're saying, that's not right. That's part of what release your ex means. Throughout the Industrial Revolution, Plymouth grew as a commercial shipping port, handling imports and passengers from the Americas. Passengers, wow. I hope I can make it through this. Oh boy. And exporting local minerals. For example, tin, copper, lime, china clay, and arsenic. While the neighboring town of Devonport became a strategic Royal Naval shipbuilding and dockyard town. In 1914, three neighboring independent towns, the county borough of Plymouth, the county borough of Devonport, and the urban district of East Stonehouse were merged to form a single county borough. The combined town took the name of Plymouth, which in 1928 achieved city status. The city's naval importance later led to its targeting and partial destruction during World War II, an act known as the Plymouth Blitz. Blitz, like in football. And a little while ago, I was thinking about something else having to do with football, and I dismissed it, and I don't know what it was now. I don't remember. After the war, the city center was completely rebuilt, and a subsequent expansion led to the incorporation of Plympton, P-L-Y-M-P-T-O-N, and Plymstock, P-L-Y-M-S-T-O-C-K, along with another outlying suburb in 1967. The city is home to 261,546, as of 2014, people, making it the 30th most populous built-up area in the United Kingdom and the second largest city in the Southwest after Bristol. It is governed locally by Plymouth City Council and is represented nationally by three MPs. Plymouth's economy remains strongly influenced by shipbuilding and seafaring, including ferry links to Brittany. In parentheses, they have Roscoff and St. Malo, M-A-L-O. And Spain, in parentheses, they have Santander, S-A-N-T-A-N-D-R. But has tended toward a service-based economy since the 1990s. It has the largest operational naval base in Western Europe, HMNB Devonport, and is home to Plymouth University. I love how they brushed over slavery. Did you hear me say slavery once at all? Nope, right? Just passengers. We talked about passengers in the 1600s. but no mention of slavery. Very, very interesting. I'm just going to scroll because, of course, they've got a whole bunch of different, after that, areas you can read. They have early history here of the town of Plymouth, early defense and Renaissance. There could be something in there because, of course, during the Renaissance, yeah, I think I see some stuff. Okay, so I'm skipping past a bunch and hopefully it won't be something we needed to know. I'm going to start from here. During the 16th century, locally produced wool was the major export commodity. Plymouth was the home port for successful maritime traders, among them Sir John Hawkins, who led England's first foray into the Atlantic slave trade, as well as Sir Francis Drake, mayor of Plymouth in 1581 and 1593. According to legend, Drake insisted on completing his game of bowls on the Hoe, H-O-E, before engaging the Spanish Armada in 1588. In 1620, the Pilgrim Fathers set sail for the New World from Plymouth, establishing Plymouth Colony, the second English colony in what is now the United States of America. And we read some of this already. During the English Civil War, Plymouth sided with the Parliamentarians and was besieged for almost 4 years by the Royalists. The Royalists are whom we read about before, having to do with the Cavaliers. So I guess this is why Spirit wanted us to see this. The last major attack by the Royalists was by Sir Richard Grenville, leading thousands of soldiers toward Plymouth, but they were defeated by the Plymouthians, P-L-Y-M-O-T-H-I-A-N-S, at Freedom Fields Park. Oh, I guess I was definitely supposed to read this. And that's not a hyperlink. Otherwise, I'd look for more information as to what Freedom Fields Park is. The Civil War ended as a parliamentary win, but monarchy was restored by King Charles II in 1660, who imprisoned many of the parliamentary heroes on Drake's Island. And I think King Charles II is the one for whom the guy Albert that they had pictured, who they said was like the basically pictorial archetype of a cavalier. I think he worked for this King Charles II, if I remember correctly from what we read before. Anyway, the monarchy was restored by King Charles II in 1660, who imprisoned many of the parliamentary heroes on Drake's Island. Construction of the Royal Citadel began in 1665 after the Restoration. It was armed with cannon facing both out to sea and into the town, rumored to be a reminder to residents not to oppose the crown. Mount Baden Tower also dates from around this time. Okay, let's see what Drake's Island was. Drake's Island is a 6.5-acre 11 island lying in Plymouth Sound, the stretch of water of the city of Plymouth, Devon, England. The rocks which make up the island are volcanic, tuff, T-U-F-F, and lava, together with marine limestone of mid-Devonian period. Okay. So I'm scrolling again. You want to see what the Royal Citadel was? The Royal Citadel in Plymouth, Devon, England, was built in the late 1660s to the design of Sir Bernard. Maybe this is why I kept thinking Bernard. I have to look up Bernard, and I didn't know what that was about. And I looked up St. Bernard. I looked up St. Bernard the dog, St. Bernard the person, Bernie Sanders. I wasn't sure what I was supposed to be looking for. Maybe this has something to do with it. It is at the eastern end of Plymouth, Hoe, H-O-E, overlooking Plymouth Sound, and encompasses the site of the earlier fort that had been built in the time of Sir Francis Drake. I guess it's just some, like a monument. Okay, I'm scrolling again. Throughout the 17th century, Plymouth had gradually lost its preeminence as a trading port. By the mid-17th century, commodities manufactured elsewhere in England cost too much to transport to Plymouth, and the city had no means of processing sugar or tobacco imports, although it did play a relatively small part in the Atlantic slave trade during the early 18th century. Small part. I wonder what that even means. I think it's just a way to minimize it and trivialize it. Because how do you play a small part in slavery? Either you enslaved people or you didn't. Yeah, I'm not sure I want to keep reading this. I'm going to get irritated. I'm going to quickly see if I see anything else that looks like it has to be read. Maybe this. Plans for Plymouth, 1943, because that's wartime again. During the First World War, Plymouth was the port of entry for many troops from around the Empire and also developed as a facility for the manufacture of munitions. Although major units of the Royal Navy moved to safety, to the safety of Scapa, S-C-A-P-A, Flo, Devonport was an important base for escort vessels and repairs. Flying boats operated from Mount Batten, B-A-T-T-E-N. In the First World War, Devonport was the headquarters of Western Approaches Command until 1941, and Sunderland, S-U-N-D-E-R-L-A-N-D, flying boats were operated by the Royal Australian Air Force. It was an important embarkation point for U.S. troops for D-Day. The city was heavily bombed by the Luftwaffe in a series of 59 raids known as the Plymouth Blitz. Although the dockyards were the principal targets, much of the city center and over 3,700 houses were completely destroyed, and more than 1,000 civilians lost their lives. This was largely due to Plymouth's status as a major port. Charles Church was hit by incendiary bombs and partially destroyed in 1941 during the Blitz, but has not been demolished, and it is now an official permanent monument to the bombing of Plymouth during World War II. The redevelopment of the city was planned by Sir Patrick Abercrombie in his 1943 plan for Plymouth, while simultaneously working on the reconstruction plan for London. And I guess that's where Abercrombie and Fitch come from, and why they sell the kind of clothes, kind and sizes to the people that they do, the type of people that they do. And you can look for yourself to find out what type that is. I'm scrolling again, because I really don't want to talk about this Plymouth place anymore. But at the same time, we have to get the point about the lack of freedom and that we have, and who, in part at least, may be responsible. So I'll read this notable people part. People from Plymouth are known as Plymouthians, P-L-Y-M-O-U-T-H-I-A-N-S, or less formally as Janners, J-A-N-N-E-R-S. Its meaning is described as a person from Devon, deriving from Cousin Jan, the Devon form of John, but more particularly in naval circles, anyone from the Plymouth area. The Elizabethan navigator, Sir Francis Drake, was born in the nearby town of Tavistock and was the mayor of Plymouth. He was the first Englishman to circumnavigate the world and was known by the Spanish as El Draco, or El Draco, meaning the dragon, after he raided many of their ships. He died of dysentery in 1596 off the coast of Puerto Rico. In 2002, a mission to recover his body and bring it to Plymouth was allowed by the Ministry of Defense. His cousin and contemporary, John Hawkins, was a Plymouth man. Painter Sir Joshua Reynolds, founder and first president of the Royal Academy, was born and educated in nearby Plympton, now part of Plymouth. William Cooksworthy, born in Kingsbridge, set up his successful porcelain business in the city and was a close friend of John Smeaton, designer of the Eddystone Lighthouse. I guess I should look and see what the Eddystone Lighthouse is. The Eddystone Lighthouse is on the dangerous Eddystone Rocks, 9 statute miles south of Ramehead, England, United Kingdom. While Ramehead is in Cornwall, the rocks are in Devon and composed of Precambrian gneiss or gneiss. I'm not sure if the G is probably silent. G-N-E-I-S-S. The current structure is the fourth to be built on the site. The first and second were destroyed by storm and fire. The third, also known as Smeaton's Tower, is the best known because of its influence on lighthouse design and its importance in the development of concrete for building. Its upper portions have been re-erected in Plymouth as a monument. The first lighthouse, completed in 1699, was the world's first offshore lighthouse. Okay. So I've gone back to the page I was on before. The naturalist Dr. William Alfred Leach, FRS, who did much to pave the way in Britain for Charles Darwin, was born at Hoe Gate in 1791. And they go on to talk about other people that are supposedly notable and important, and you guys can look them up. I don't really feel like going through this. I got to get back to where I was or what I started to talk about. I do see something here about Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson, though. That's here. So let me see if I can figure that out. Oh, they're talking about an actor, the actor who played that role in a movie. Okay, so that's not important for us. I think I did what I was supposed to see, the part about Darwin and about the lighthouse. And of course, the lack of parts about slavery. I'm sure I was supposed to see that too. Transport, I'll go over this quickly. The A38, so 11 dual carriageway, runs from east to west across the north of the city. Within the city, it is designated as the parkway and represents the boundary between the urban parts of the city and the generally more recent suburban areas. Okay, I thought that was going to be something when I saw A38, or maybe it is. Heading east, it connects Plymouth to the M5 motorway near Exeter, E-X-E-T-E-R. And heading west, it connects Cornwall and Devon via the Tamar Bridge. Regular bus service, maybe this is why I was being shown buses and bridges, or another reason why at least. Regular bus services are provided by Plymouth City Bus, First Southwest, and Target Travel. There are 3 park and ride services located at Mile House, Collipool, Plympton, and George Junction. George. Plymouth City Airport, which are operated by First Southwest. And they're showing a picture here, the Royal Albert Bridge from 1859 is the closest one they're showing. And then there's the Tamar Bridge, built in 1961, behind it. And the two of these connect Cornwall with Plymouth. Okay, I'm going to leave Plymouth alone and get back to the United States. Actually, the part that I read before about Luftwaffe, Luftwaffe, although I don't know what that is, and the number 99 that kept showing up with the year and everything, has reminded me of 99 Luftballons. A song about, it's a German anti-war song, a protest song Let me tell you about that. Maybe that's what I was supposed to do. Okay, from Wikipedia. 99 Luftballons is an anti-war protest song by the German band Nena, N-E-N-A, from their 1983 self-titled album. An English version titled 99 Red Balloons with lyrics by Kevin McAlea, M-C-A-L-E-A, was also released on the album 99 Luftballons in 1984, after widespread success of the original in Europe and Japan. The English version is not a direct translation of the German and contains somewhat different lyrics, but that's the one I will have to read if I can find it, although I remember my father knowing the German version because he spent so much time there during the Vietnam War, and actually is quite fond of Germany, or it was. "99 Red Balloons" lyrics. You and I in a little toy shop buy a bag of balloons with the money we've got. Set them free at the break of dawn, till one by one they were gone. Back at base, bugs in the software flashed the message, something's out there. Floating in the summer sky, 99 red balloons go by. 99 red balloons floating in the summer sky. Panic bells, it's red alert. There's something here from somewhere else. The war machine springs to life, opens up one eager eye, focusing it on the sky. Where 99 red balloons go by, 99 Decision Street, 99 ministers meet. To worry, super scurry, call the troops out in a hurry. This is what we've waited for. This is it, boys, this is the war. The president is on the line. They used to have the red phone, or talk about the red phone in the 80s. That's the line the president would get on if it was time to go to war. As 99 red balloons go by, 99 knights of the air ride super high-tech jet fighters. Everyone's a superhero. Everyone's a Captain Kirk with orders to identify, to clarify, to classify. Scramble in the summer sky, 99 red balloons go by. As 99 red balloons go by, 99 dreams I have had. In every one a red balloon. It's all over and I'm standing pretty in this dust that was a city. If I could find a souvenir just to prove the world was here, and here is a red balloon, I think of you and let it go. Wow. And there's another red, negative red, to go along with the others that I had come up with the other day. One of the Angelics and I had spoke about that song a few weeks back. She said she was reminded of it by something and wanted to mention it. And I said, oh, that's funny. I was reminded of it by, you know, because of this. And I mentioned my dad too, that he used to sing the one in German. I don't remember what we were talking about though, or what brought that up. Anyway, let me get back to what I started with and to try to come full circle. St. Andrew's Cross. And I will include a picture that I took. I didn't get the statue, the concrete statue, but I did get the bronze one. So I will include a picture of St. Andrew with his cross. Okay. So I already read about the Confederate flag, right? The saltire is seen on the USA's Confederate flag, showing the Scottish lineage of many Southerners. It was not the official flag of the Confederate States, but it was nevertheless widely referred to as the Confederate flag, and is still today. On this flag, the saltire is known as the Southern Cross. So that was, it was the Southern Cross that led me on that detour that I am now back from. The saltire is also seen on several national flags, particularly where there is a historical cultural connection with St. Andrew. And I would dare I add, and or Britain. Because there's an X on Jamaica's flag, even. Not, does that have anything to do with St. Andrew? I don't know. Anyway, let me read this. One of the best known saltires is the flag of Scotland. This white cross on a blue background is called St. Andrew's Cross, St. Andrew being the patron saint of Scotland. A red cross on a white background is the St. Patrick's Cross, representing the patron saint of Ireland. Both of these crosses were superimposed on England's red cross on a white background, St. George's Cross, to give the United Kingdom's Union Flag, or they have in parentheses, Union Jack. Let me click on St. George's Cross. St. George's Cross, the cross has all four members the same shape and form, crux, C-R-U-X, quadrata, Q-U-A-D-R-T-A, and was popular with Greek Christians who favored symmetrical art. Well, I like symmetrical art too. I like naturally forming geometric shapes in the earth. That's why I love this piece of mine. Naturally forming metal squares. To speak of that. Anyway, the Greek cross is also called St. George's Cross and the King George's Cross. The Greek cross has all four members the same shape and form. Okay, they're repeating that. And usually represents the church rather than a symbol for Christ's suffering. Oh, interesting. It appears as a plus sign in liturgical documents to indicate where the priest should make the sign of the cross. For example, the peace, P-A-C-E, plus sign of the Lord, B, plus sign, always with, plus sign, you. This cross can be seen on ancient gravestones in Roman catacombs. In 1958 AD, a red cross with a white background became the flag of Genoa. In the 12th century, crusaders from England adopted the design for their own use and took it back to England as the Red Cross of St. George. See Union Flag to understand why this differs from the more familiar British flag. Okay, I'll have to see that, but I'm seeing something about Ethiopia first, which I'm sure I'm supposed to read. And it just sort of left my screen. Okay, here it is. In Laibela, L-A-L-I-B-E-L-A, Ethiopia, the shape was the template for the monolithic churches carved from a single block of stone. Oh, wow. And they have a picture here. I'll see if I can download it. In the 12th century, perhaps the most famous is the Church of St. George. Oh, great. A place of pilgrimage and devotion for Christians, registered by UNESCO as a heritage site, consequently overvisited by tourists, which in turn has led to infestation of corrupt tour guides and other con merchants. If you go there, let me scroll down. If you go there, what? Yeah, if you go there, comma, oh, caveat lector. C-A-V-E-A-T-L-E-C-O-R. I'm not sure what that means. Maybe like your own risk or something. And then they have a picture of the monolithic church of St. George at Laibela, Ethiopia. So supposedly this is carved out of one piece of stone into the shape of a cross and is a church. Variations. The Maltese cross is similar to the Greek cross, but with flayed ends. It is a very popular
popular basis in heraldic designs where it is called the patte, P-A-T-T-E-E cross. The Greek cross is the basis for the swastika. We know that to not be true, so I'm not sure where this is going or from where this is, because that Jainism was from the, the year 300, and that was where the swastika came from, where the swastika had come. So I don't know, I'm confused. But anyway, favored by Adolf Hitler in the Second World War, this variation was a symbol of the extreme right. The swastika's history, however, goes much further back. Another and equally famous variation of the Greek cross is the emblem of the Red Cross. More than 100 years ago, the International Red Cross was founded to aid those wounded in battle. The objective of the Red Cross emblem was to have a unified distinctive sign that would be respected internationally. An admirable idea, but the Red Cross has made some people see red and get very cross about its use of the cross. Then there's the Blue Cross, used by a UK animal charity, the Green Cross for first aid and safety, and the Orange Cross, used by loyalists in Northern Ireland. In its most common color, the Black Cross has been the favorite of several political organizations. National and regional flags that incorporate the Greek cross are: the Greek cross doesn't appear on the emblem of the Greek Orthodox Church of Greece. Their emblem features the Byzantine double-headed eagle and has a tiny cross atop a crown, but it does appear on the national flag of Greece. It also appears on many other national and regional flags, including Alderney, Guernsey, Guernsey, I don't know what this is, Guernsey, Allende, Allande, Spain, Barn, B-A-A-R-N, Netherlands, Barceloneta, B-A-R-C-E-L-O-N-E-T-A, Puerto Rico, Bonn, B-O-N-N, Germany, Brittany, B-R-I-T-T-A-N-Y, France, Church in Wales, W-A-L-E-S, UK, Cornwall, UK, Democratic Progressive Party of Taiwan, Derbyshire, UK, Devon, UK, Dominica, Dominican Republic, Dorset, UK, England, UK, Gdansk, probably with the G is probably silent, G-D-A-N-S-K, Poland, Georgia, and I'm assuming this is the country of Georgia, not the state of Georgia, but so let me click on it. Georgia took me to something, Crusaders Cross. It is sometimes confused with the Teutonic, T-E-U-T-O-N-I-C cross, bestowed by Pope Innocent III to knights near the end of the 12th century. The Jerusalem cross can also be confused with the St. Julian's cross, the St. Chad's cross, and the cross crosslet, which are used more in heraldic coats of arms rather than the Christian symbols. The Jerusalem cross is often called the Crusaders cross because it was on the papal banner given to the Crusaders by Pope Urban II in the Middle Ages. See also Maltese cross by the Hospitallers, H-O-S-T-P-I-T-A-L-L-E-R-S. Not all these crusading knights were God-fearing Christians. For many, it was just a job that would ensure they received rich payment back home, just as the Crusades of today. The prize for many was economic gain rather than spreading the gospel. And those weren't my words. That's what I just read from this website. Today's Crusades. If we take just a little bit of time to look, we can see again and again through history that when the destructive instinct is awakened within those who wield power, an absurd and tragic war inevitably follows. It has nothing to do with the label attached to that power: Christianity, Islam, globalization, communism. It has everything to do with the inherent selfishness and greed of humans in power. But for those of us living in free countries, I don't know where this person is from, let us not forget who permits such people to rule. Before giving our vote, let's make sure that the candidate has read and understood sufficient history. And this is from, again, that website, www.seiyaku.com. And now I'm on /custom/crosses/Jerusalem.html #Georgia, because I clicked on a hyperlink. So now I'm going back to where I was. Gloucestershire, UK, Gornji, Milanovac, Milanovac, Groningen, Groningen, Netherlands, Guernsey, Guernsey, Herm Guernsey, London, UK, Madeira, Madeira, Malta, Malta, Mantova, Italy, Mantova, Marseille, France, Marseille, France, Montreal, Canada, Morsin, Morcin, Spain, Muscogee Nation, Muscogee, Netherlands, Antilles, Antilles, something in another language, Neuchâtel, Switzerland, Piedmont, Italy, Quebec, Canada, Santa Cruz de Mompox, Mompox, Colombia, Sardinia, Italy. Oh, Sardinia, Italy. Was that where that special place was? I've got to try to remember. Something was in Sardinia, Italy. Swiss, Switzerland, S-C-H-W-Y-Z. Stiges, Sitges, S-I-T-G-E-S, Spain, Switzerland, Tonga, T-O-N-G-A, Utrecht Province, U-T-R-E-C-H-T, Netherlands, Wales, UK, and I don't know what this is, Zytomyr, Z-H-Y-T-O-M-Y-R, Oblast, O-B-L-A-S-T, Ukraine. Okay. This thing keeps taking me like in another direction. I'm trying to get through St. Andrew's Cross. And that was just all about the Greek cross.
Wait, speaking of naturally occurring geometric shapes, I have to show y'all my X and my OX again for those who missed it. And for those who saw it, I don't care. I have to keep showing it and showing. I love it so much. This is the X. On this side, there's another X. Naturally occurring X's, said to be made of fairy tears, fairies who wept at the death of Jesus. Their tears formed X's. This one says, OX, my famous, theme words. People say, XO, and I say, nope, OX. Mwah. OX. Ox. I love these. Okay. I'm back to St. Andrew's cross. Okay. In the Spanish Canary Islands, just off the western Sahara coast, the 19th century masters of the island of Tenerife, Tenerife, belonged to the Masonic Grand Lodge of Scotland. Okay, so these were Masons. It's possible that they influenced the choice of the island's flag, which is probably why in that movie, Rosewood, and I guess in real life in Rosewood, when that foolishness sparked that led to so much senseless death and the burning down of a perfectly self-sufficient functioning black community, the black gentleman said to these white southerners in Florida, I'm of Mason. I guess he's saying, I'm one of y'all's brothers. Like, what is going on here? And then we know what went on. To take us back to one of the reasons why the universe, spirit, source, is not happy with the state of Florida in many respects, and a number of its inhabitants. Okay. So these people in the Spanish Canary Islands were believed to have belonged to the Masonic Grand Lodge of Scotland. It's possible that they influenced the choice of the island's flag, albeit a slightly darker shade of blue. The blue represents the color of the Atlantic Ocean, and white represents the winter snow caked Mount Teide, T-E-I-D-E. So I think the Canary Islands are warm, hot, tropical, so perhaps this is like California, where at the high altitude it's cold and there's snow on the mountains, and then when you get down, you know, back to sea level, it's warm. I don't know. I'm guessing. For the Scottish flag, the colors are said to come from a white cross made by clouds in the blue sky. In the 9th century, King Angus, like Angus Beef, A-N-G-U-S, saw this arrangement on the day before a decisive battle over the English Northumbrian Angles. Northumbrian, N-O-R-T-H-U-M-B-R-I-A-N. Okay, that's with a capital N. So it's like Northumbrian Angles. A-N-G-L-E-S is also capitalized. Maybe this means versus, you know, some pure white, like Anglo-Saxon people. I'm not sure what English Northumbrian Angles were. But anyway, they were commanded by Athelstan, A-L-T-H-E-L-S-T-A-N. So we'll have to look up these people, I guess. This is not a hyperlink. King Angus considered to be a good omen and won the battle. Okay. Merkel, isn't that the name of the woman from Germany? That's involved in this Brexit, this breaking away of Britain from the European Union. I'm going to have to look up Merkel in a second. But anyway, Merkel, M-E-R-K-I-L, I'm sorry, K-I-L-L, was the place where King Angus's army of Picts, capital P-I-C-T-S, and Scots were fighting the king, Athel's, A-T-H-E-L's army of Sassenachs. This sound like Indians, natives. S-A-S-S-E-N-A-C-H-S from Northumbria. One night, Angus prayed to God for help in the next day's battle. A vision of Saint Andrew appeared to him, promising victory. The next day, King Angus's men saw two long white clouds streaking across the blue sky, forming a cross. Oh, wow. They took this as a sign from St. Andrew and were sufficiently roused to beat the lowlanders in this battle. Again, I'm wondering if this has anything to do with all my friends know the lowrider. Lowlanders, the lowrider. One of the angelics pointed out to me that song is by ZZ Top. And I said, ooh. First of all, the ZZ and the Top. And she recognized the Top, too. She said, I keep seeing Top, and I do, too. Top, toy. I keep seeing. I don't know what these words mean. Maybe I should break them down in Freemason language and check. But I keep seeing those. And the Z was doing something to me, too. Maybe having to do with Zed? I don't know. ZZ Top. And then on top of that, I said, ooh, isn't he a redhead with a long red beard? She said, yeah. So at least I know those are very, very likely angelics of the light. I just don't know what I'm supposed to be learning from them or their song. All my friends know the lowrider. The lowrider is a little higher. He's more elevated. So that wouldn't make sense here because they won the battle against the Lowlanders, these people. Why would St. Andrew have helped them to beat the Angels of the Light? So that doesn't make sense. I gotta keep thinking, and you guys can help me. All right, anyway. Of course, the sign could have been meant for King Aethel's men. Oh, but perhaps they were too busy fighting to be looking up at the sky. Or were these clouds the exhaust of jet engines from some early alien visitation? Or earthquake clouds? Oh, there's a lot of possibilities here. But if they had been for the other team, and maybe they lost because they weren't paying attention, which we do sometimes, we have God in front of us in some form, not calling St. Andrew God per se, but of course he was representing God that day. He was sent by God, so he would be God small g at worst, you know, in a lower vibration of God, still making him small g again at worst. Sometimes God is there trying to tell us something, and not only do we not see, like, we ignore, we're just too busy with what we want to do. So that is a possibility. And of course aliens are a possibility too. I don't know. Or earthquake clouds. I don't even know what an earthquake cloud is. Okay. So it's like, you know, don't start me to lying. Whatever interpretation we wish to make, the Scots believed it was nothing less than a miracle. This battle took place just a stone's throw from a village later known as Markle in East Lothian, or Lothian, I'm not sure, Lothian, Scotland. Markle village has now gone, but a few ruins remain. For example, Markle Castle. The original name of the place was Merkle, and this might have come from the word miracle. Oh, maybe like with an accent, like miracle. Like I could see somebody from down south, and I guess Scotland, because some of them, and now my memory, there goes my memory again, but some of them from a particular area have a thicker, heavier accent. Oh, goodness. I lost it. But I could see it. Again, even from the south, I could see them saying, and they're saying that the south was full of these Scottish people. Maybe that's why they speak as they do. But I could see somebody from down south saying miracle, and that being miracle or Merkel, or, you know, like, take your pick. Anyway, the white cross on the blue background was adopted as the flag of Scotland, and St. Andrew became Scotland's patron saint. Okay, well, at least they thanked him. It is of no surprise, therefore, that St. Andrew's cross is the basis for many Scottish logos, in particular the Church of Scotland emblem, which also depicts the miraculous burning bush that was not consumed from Exodus 3. Okay, this is hyperlinked. I'm going to click on Exodus 3. Now, Moses was shepherding the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, M-I-D-I-A-N, and he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to the mountain of God, to Horeb. The angel of the Lord appeared to him, and in a flame of fire within a bush, he looked, and the bush was ablaze with fire, but it was not being consumed. So Moses thought, I will turn aside to see this amazing sight. Why does the bush not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to look, God called to him from within the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. God said, Do not approach any closer. Take your sandals off your feet. I guess because feet were unclean, maybe. Feet are seen as unclean. That's why seraphim cover their feet with their wings. They have six, and they use two to cover their feet, two to cover their eyes, and two to fly, I think. Do not approach any closer. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Yeah, I think because feet are unclean, he had shoes on. He added, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Exactly. That's why he told him not to come any closer and not to, you know, I guess he shouldn't have turned. He didn't know. And again, why seraphs and seraphim, the plural, use their wings to cover their eyes, their feet, their genitals, so as not to look directly at the face of the Lord, but it's also so as not to disrespect him by having, like, you know, genitals or unclean, something unclean like feet, and be shown in his presence. The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry because of the taskmakers, for I know their sorrows. I have come down to deliver them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up that land to a land that is both good and spacious, to a land flowing with milk and honey. I'm like tearing up. Like, this is even sad. This is happy. I'm not sure what's happening to me right now. To the region of Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now indeed the cry of the Israelites has come to me, and I have also seen how severely the Egyptians oppress them. So now go, and I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. Maybe because the other day I was thinking, I told you when I was having that conversation with my soul sister, I said, I feel like if we really pray for one another, and if I'm really able to forge this union with my twin, I feel like I hear Moses saying, like, let my people go, like there'll be mass exodus. Maybe that's why I'm crying right now. I'm sorry. It's not like me. Oh. One sec. I've wiped my eyes, but every time I look back at this, I begin to tear up again. So I guess that's what it's going to have to be. At the same time, God, Spirit is telling me to take off another mask and to include a picture of myself with this video in all my illuminated glory, you know, surrounded by my orbs, the archangels. And that maybe, just maybe, after that, maybe that will help you, some of you, to decide from then on who to watch and who not to. Maybe that will help some of you to help yourselves and move you to stop sending hundreds and thousands of dollars to people who can't really help you. And to instead send me only what you can afford, like the word says to do. He's saying, I'm a watchman. I have to ring the bell. Okay, I'm ringing the bell. I'm going to include a picture of myself. I will be somewhat illuminated in said picture. And hopefully it will help you to discern, yes, this is an angel of the light. Perhaps some of those other ones that I've been watching have not been. Let me stop. Let me finally cut it out. And hopefully it doesn't have to just come from me. Hopefully Spirit has been speaking to you directly and trying to coax you to get rid of some of these things in your life, and you weren't quite sure, maybe you just need this one final push and that'll be it. Because I hate to, you know, be the one to tell you to stop. I hate to be the one to come across like I'm envious or jealous of you, you know, engaging with other people, because I'm not. I'm not. But I am saddened and afraid for some of you, because I know you're talking to the wrong people. I know you're watching the wrong people. I know you're engaging with the wrong people. And it can happen to any of us. I told you, I myself engage with Beelzebub. It can happen to anybody, but you got to stop. You can't continue. That's not how you want to be caught at the end, you know, when you're about to be judged. It's not. Okay, so let me get back to this, and hopefully I can do it without crying, and, you know, feeling like I'm missing my family. The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry because of their taskmakers, for I know their sorrows. I have come down to deliver them from the land of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a land that is both good and spacious, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the region of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, P-E-R-I-Z-Z. Oh, maybe that's where the ZZ Top came from. I-T-S. Maybe that's why I keep focusing on the ZZ. I don't know. Hivites and Jebusites. And now indeed the cry of the Israelites has come to me, and I have also seen how severely the Egyptians oppressed them. So now go, and I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? That's how I feel, some, you know, a lot of the time. Or that I should bring the Israelites out of Egypt. You know, that I should be telling you, allow me to help you out of Egypt. I mean, you know, essentially. Allow me to help to save you Israelites. Like, who am I? But at the same time, I know who I am. I am who I am. I know who I am. I know who my father is. I wish you all did. Oh, God. I'm sorry. All right. Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, or that I should bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He replied, surely I will be with you, and this will be the sign that you, to you, that I have sent you. When you bring the people out of Egypt, you and they will serve God on this mountain. Moses said to God, if I go to the Israelites and tell them, the God of your fathers. I'm so sorry. If I go to the Israelites and tell them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What should I say to them? God said to Moses, I am that I am. I can't right now. I'll be back. I'm sorry, guys. That got really intense for me. But I'm back. In the meantime, I went to get my hair done. My daughters and I heard a lot of music before I left. Even like, and it was like old music, like Elvis and things like that. I, you know, quickly took note of it so that I could go over it when I got back. And then, of course, at the hairdresser again, I heard all kinds of other songs. Jodeci, All My Life, I Pray for Someone Like You. I thank God that I finally found you. All my life, I pray for someone like you. And I hope that you feel the same way, too. Yes, I do hope that you love me too. You're all that I ever know. When you smile on my face, all I see is a glow. You turn my life around. You pick me up when I was down. You're all that I ever know. When you smile, my face glows. You pick me up when I was down. And goes on from there. That was from memory. Mariah Carey, early Mariah Carey. Love takes time to heal when you're hurting so much. Couldn't see that I was blind to let you go, but I can't mistake the pain inside, because love takes time. I don't want to be here alone. Michael Jackson, Remember the Time When We Fell in Love. Remember the time. all kinds of songs. Nat King Cole came on. I mean, it was, you know, the same thing that was happening to me at home happened to me at the salon. And I noticed other pictures, not just Norma Jean or Marilyn Monroe, but actually even with regard to Norma Jean, I said, those are my parents' names. I hadn't realized that last week. Norma, my father is Norman, and Jean, my mother is basically Little John in Spanish. Her name is Juanita. That's Little John. That's Norma Jean, Norma John, Norman John. So I'm not sure what that's about, really. I don't know. But I saw other pictures there, too. She had everybody that I had, like, that I have ever mentioned. Sophia Loren, who I've mentioned before, because I said that my dad always said my mother looked like Sophia Loren. Elizabeth Taylor, Natalie Wood, Nat King Cole, Elvis, Frank Sinatra, Harry Belafonte, all these people, there were pictures of them on the wall in the hair salon, my little Dominican hair salon of, you know, two people that worked there, mother and daughter. So very interesting, very, very interesting. And again, I heard a lot of songs there. And I am refreshed and I am back. Again, yeah, there was that, I don't know, it just got very emotional reading that. I've mentioned before that it's possible that my soul was Moses, because I've felt other things before. I'm not positive, but I think so. And I think that's why I got so overwhelmed. I'm going to try this again, because I need to get through this. But first, let me explain some other things or clarify some other things that I said that may have been unclear since I was, you know, not completely myself in that moment. So I am not saying, God is not saying that you can, you know, can't watch anybody, you know, on YouTube or Facebook or whatever it is you do, you know, aside from me. That's not what we're saying. Again, there's enough abundance to go around, and this, the universe wants its children to be abundant. So all of them, not just me, all of them, you and those whom you're watching who are indeed of the light. However, many of you are watching and engaging with beings that are not really of the light. And as we've discussed before, yes, the light does come. The dark does present itself often as an angel, as a being of the light. They just can't keep it up. So eventually they'll say something strange or, you know, have a strange look about them or both. And you should be able to figure out, something's not right here. And I think the fact that, you know, a lot of you have not done that in some cases is what, you know, the universe continues to ask me to warn you of, that this has to change, and it has to change soon. You have to start paying attention and disengaging from, you know, the collective consciousness and just a mixing of thoughts, ideas, vibrations that don't align with your own, don't resonate with your own, and don't align or resonate with the universe's message. That is the way to stay on path. And again, it's not just me or just people that I've said, because there's actually other people that I've seen either, you know, with some regularity, like more than once, or, you know, I've come across that I would vouch for. I would say that this person is of the light from what I've seen. Again, anything can happen to any of us at any time if we allow ourselves to be contaminated and or consumed by the dark. So even that doesn't mean much. We just have to keep our eyes open, pay attention, listen. Listen, as the cards have been saying. Okay, that's the message the universe is trying to tell you. Pay attention. And then you'll see. You'll see who maybe is not, you know, who you thought they were. Okay. I don't remember what else I said that I may have wanted to clarify. Oh, so I'll just get back to this. Let me start from somewhere where it'll make sense. Okay, the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry because of the taskmakers, for I know their sorrows. I have come down to deliver them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a land that is both good and spacious, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the region of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now indeed the cry of the Israelites has come to me, and I have also seen how severely the Egyptians oppressed them. So now go, and I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh or that I should bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He replied, surely I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that I have sent you. When you bring the people out of Egypt, you and they will serve God on this mountain. Moses said to God, if I go to the Israelites and tell them, the God of your fathers has sent me, and they ask me, what is his name? And they have a lowercase h here. That always makes me cringe. What should I say to them? God said to Moses, I am that I am. And he said, you must say this to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, you must say this to the Israelites. The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial from generation to generation. Go and bring together the elders of Israel and tell them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, appeared to me, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I have attended carefully to you, to what has been done to you in Egypt, and I have promised that I will bring you up out of affliction of Egypt, to the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Oops. Wait, hang on. Something just happened here. Oh, boy. The elders will listen to you, and then you and the elders of Israel must go to the king of Egypt and tell him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. So now, let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness so that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go, not even under force. So I will extend my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders that I will do among them. And after that, he will release you. I will grant this people favor with Egyptians, so that when you depart, you will not leave empty-handed. Every woman will ask her neighbor and the one who happens to be staying in her house for items of silver and gold and for clothing. You will put these articles on your sons and daughters. Thus, you will plunder Egypt. Okay. Let me go back to what I had been reading. I do want to say, though, also, I did think about this. The picture that I'm going to include, you may want to compare it to the High Priestess card in the tarot. For me, the resemblance was completely accidental, but I'm sure that it was by design from the universe's perspective, that, you know, they did it on purpose. Because as I've mentioned before, I had been told by spirit, you're the high priestess. I didn't know what that meant. And then I got this mysterious book about Isis in the mail. My sister, soul sister had purchased for me the deck of Isis cards that came with the book. But about 2 weeks prior to I was to receive what she had purchased for me, I got a book by itself. like out of nowhere. And I contacted her. I said, I've been getting, you know, hearing from God, I think I'm ISIS. And I explained to her about the book. And she was the only person I had told at the time. But by then I had already been, I had already experienced the high priestess thing. God had already been telling me that I was the high priestess. I had already had my Akashic record read, that revealed that I was of the ascended master's realm of the Emerald Ray. Definitely a key holder, which explained why I had keys to all sorts of things, turn up all over the place. Definitely a time jumper. All of that was in there. And then I had gone for my reading, with Agatha of Psychic Consultants. And then she was told the same thing through the card. She said, Spirit says you're the high priestess, go be the high priestess. And I still had to figure out at that time, what does that mean? What does that mean, God? What, go be the high priestess. And that's when the ISIS book turned up, and as soon as I opened it, which is one of the things that prompted me to contact my soul sister, as soon as I opened it to the page that said that she was the high priestess. And then shortly after, I noticed in the Rider-Waite tarot deck the picture of the high priestess, or the high priestess card, Major Arcana card number 2. Look like me, or I look like it, or at least resembled it in this one picture in particular that I'm going to include with this video. So that was how I came to know who I was, or began to at least. And this is, I'm going to, in the same way or with the same things, I am going to reintroduce myself to you, reveal my face, you know, my full likeness, again, with some of my lights around. So maybe in this picture, not fully illuminated, but definitely with my orbs hanging over my head. You shall see. And then you will know. And then you can think, perhaps, have I seen other people like this? And just because they're not, doesn't, so maybe you won't, because other people aren't lit up, doesn't mean they're not of the light either. Because even some of the people that I've mentioned that I'd say I would swear were of the light, they're not lit up on their channels either. So, but I think being lit up might speak for something. It might help you to, if you have questions about me, which you may. You know, that's fine. This may help you to answer them in a positive way. Okay, I'm going to look for that page that we were on. The burning bush symbol is repeated in the emblems of the Presbyterian churches around the world and represents the bondage of the Church of Egypt. Their emblems remind us that the church and the faithful... The emblems remind us that the church and the faithful, okay, in every age and every culture may suffer severe persecution, and yet God prevents his people from being destroyed. A similar design is seen on the flag of Tallahassee, the capital of Florida, and a variation of the St. Andrew's cross is the Burgundy cross. All these crosses represent the Christian religion of the kings and rulers at the time the flags and banners were made. Other national flags have an X cross, but these have no Christian basis. I don't know who told them that or how that was determined, but that's what it says here. The flag of Burundi, B-U-R-U-N-D-I, for example, where even though the country is nominally Christian, the white cross is not used as a religious symbol. It is a symbol of peace, the goal of everyone after years of ethnic violence between Hutu and Tutsi factions. Oh, okay, that makes sense. That's in Africa then. The flag of Grenada just happens to have a cross made by the four triangles of wisdom, warmth, vegetation, and agriculture. Amen. I like that. They look like pyramids. Perhaps they are. Perhaps that's what they should be. And there's six stars here. Maybe the universal energy of six. I don't know. The yellow gold cross on the Jamaican flag signifies sunshine, as with the Republic of Macedonia's flag. Okay, I was thinking maybe Jamaica had that because of the British influence. The Republic of Macedonia, their flag has several like rays coming out of it. It looks more like that hieroglyphic star I told you represents Horus than one of these X crosses to me. Although it also looks like a regular cross on its side and an X cross through that one. Yeah, okay, I see it now. And of course, Nova Scotia, whose name is Latin for New Scotland. I mentioned that earlier. Flags with patches and more. And so this is some kind of sail. Now they're showing the Confederate flag and then some other flags with X's. And then here's something about a windmill. Dr. Van Helsing took advantage of the windmill's cross to dispatch the creepy vampire in the 1960 Hammer movie. Oh, I guess I was supposed to see this. Hammer movie, The Brides of Dracula. A 3.5 minute video of the scene is here, and see the Dracula cross if you're interested in that sort of thing. I certainly am not. Because if you believe in vampires, they can't cross onto consecrated ground, you know, like holy, where holy people are, or, you know, so churches and cemeteries that are like blessed and attached to churches, or things like my house, unless they are invited in. So I won't be inviting any in. The use of windmills declined during the Industrial Revolution, and very few remain today. They should come back, though. They're cleaner for the environment. Some have been converted into museums, tourist information centers, craft shops, and even homes. But we do not know of any that have been converted into churches or chapels. A few mock windmills have been built as wedding chapels, taking advantage of the romantic image of the windmill and, of course, the huge blades that form a cross. Finally, there's a variation of St. Andrew's cross on the flag of the Vatican. See the papal cross. Since the 14th century, two crossed keys have been the official insignia of the Holy See, S-E-E. These keys are the symbols of St. Peter. Popes are considered direct descendants of St. Peter's office. The keys were given to Peter, see Matthew 16:19, by Christ to open the doors to paradise, just as the cross opens the gates of heaven for those who believe in him. So that's probably why Archangel Metatron, as well as the goddess Isis, walk around holding their Ankh keys, the keys to life, according to them, all the time. Archangel Metatron, who, of course, is the god Thot at a higher vibration. Archangel Metatron, who, of course, was Enoch of the Book of Enoch and Thomas and Enoch. This Matthew 16:19. Let me see what that's about. I won't read the whole chapter of 16. I'll just go to the keys. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will have been bound in heaven. So as above, so below. And whatever you release on earth will have been released in heaven. Then he instructed his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. Okay, that's the end of that part. So maybe we want to come back one day and read Matthew 16. The note at the bottom says that today, St. Andrew's cross means humility and sacrifice. So I guess that takes us back to what the universe was showing me they meant by release your inner ex, or at least one aspect of release your inner ex, because there have been several, as we've been talking about. But this particular one, with regard to being likened to St. Andrew, is about taking a stand. Okay, he doesn't want us to be embarrassed of him, you know, by keeping our mouths shut. We imply that we are embarrassed. If we know better and we don't say, why aren't we saying? We don't want anybody to see us. Okay, that's what he's saying. So as far as the actual martyrdom, St. Andrew has already done that on our behalf. And now all we have to do is speak up. At risk of persecution, yes, at risk of people talking about us, laughing at us, making fun of us, whatever the case is going to be. There's one other variation of the cross here we might want to talk about. I don't know. The Chi that I started out with, C-H-I-R-H-O cross, the Chi or Chai Rho cross. They also call this Constantine's cross. That's why I thought maybe we might want to mention it. Because the cross is formed with a P and X, it is sometimes misnamed as Pax cross, P-A-X cross. The correct name is Chi Rho cross, with or without a hyphen, and this page explains why. It is also sometimes called an XP cross. And in the picture, it is an X with a P going through it. So it looks kind of like... I'll try to include pictures. I can't even describe this. I was going to say, kind of like the male-female symbols. Kind of like an Ankh. But then again, not really. do an internet search for XP and cross, and you'll find the pages about Microsoft's cross-platform operating system, Windows XP. Interesting. You might also find some interesting articles on another XP, or Xeroderma pigmentosum, which is a rare and incurable genetic disorder. People with XP must stay out of the sun, since for them, Windows can result in cancer. Wow. A particularly bright light appeared in the noonday sky over 1700 years ago, just before the Battle of Milvian, M-I-L-V-I-A-N, bridge. Oh, here, another bridge. Okay, so let me read that sentence again so that it makes sense. A particular bright light appeared in the noon sky over 1700 years ago, just before the Battle of Milvian Bridge, an important crossing point over the Tiber, northern Rome. The Roman Emperor Constantine saw this and at the same time heard the words, "In hoc signo vinces," in this sign you shall conquer. He took this as a sign from God and decided the shape drawn by the light should be an emblem for his military. This emblem became known as Labarum, L-A-B-A-R-U-M. The shape he saw was a flaming cross. Oh, remember the other day I saw a burning cross in my candle? I tried to take a picture of it. There was a burning cross in my candle. I tried to move the camera next to it so you guys could see it. That's what I tried to do. Huh. Okay, this might be what that was about. So the shape he saw was a flaming cross, a long sphere overlaid with gold. It had a crossbar, and on the top of the hole was fixed a wreath of gold and precious stones. And within this, the symbol of the Savior's name, two letters indicating the name of Christ by means of the initial letters, the letter X, intersection P at the center. Oh. The Greek word for Christ is Christos, and the Greek lettering is X. And then they have some other stuff next to it. You guys can look that up. it's like X-P-O-T-O-C or something. The first letter X, Chi, C-H-I, shaped like the St. Andrew's cross, and the second letter P, Rho, form the monogram of Christ. Add this to Alpha, A, and Omega, that symbol, And we have a complete acronym for the words of Jesus. I am the Alpha and the Omega. See Alpha and Omega Cross. The Chi Rho appears in logos of several churches and mission institutes. For example, the Sisters and Brothers of Mary Knoll, M-A-R-Y-K-N-O-L-L, the Church of Uganda, and others. Often referred to as Chrismon, C-H-R-I-S-M-O-N, the XP combination became the monogram of Constantine. Coincidentally, the labarum was similar to an existing pagan emblem used as a standard by the Roman cavalry. Constantine was the Pontifex Maximus, chief priest of the classical Roman pagan religion. So it is easy to see why he was warmed to the symbol. When I read that he was warned by the light, I'm not going to argue that. That's what it says here. I was thinking how interesting that was, because I'm like, as far as I knew, Constantine was like on the other side, like it says here, pagan religion, that he was in part responsible for, removing books of the Bible during the Byzantine era. That's what I remember. I could be wrong, but now it doesn't seem like I am. So anyway, we can look this up. So it is easy to see why he was warm to the symbol, because it reminded him of his pagan symbol. So why would Jesus's symbol, the symbol for Jesus's name, or I am the Alpha and the Omega, look like a pagan symbol? Something doesn't make sense to me. Anyway, the timing of witnessing the sign was significant. It was the 27th of October, the year 312, the day before an important battle on Milvian Bridge, M-I-L-V-I-A-N, Bridge, which he won. Since Chi and Rho formed the monogram of Christ, he understood it was a sign from the Christian God. And thenceforth, Constantine became more tolerant of Christianity. Oh, okay. So maybe that's what it was about. Jesus trying to make him more tolerant. However, we can't imagine Constantine as a holy good guy and tolerant of other religions. Jews were required to convert to Christianity, and if they refused, they were regarded as outcasts and devil worshippers. During the Second World War, Hitler hid behind the Catholic Church and the swastika cross to persecute the Jews. And today, the current bellicose war on terror, the absurd and tragic war on reality, hosted by Christian nations hiding behind their cross, has led to increased persecution of Muslims. There has been slaughter of Muslims by Christians in Kosovo, genocide by Muslims, Romans, Catholics, and Serbian Orthodox followers against each other in Bosnia, Herzegovina, mass murder of Roman Catholics by Muslims in East Timor, T-I-M-O-R, and as with Constantine, all these people started on a path they had convinced themselves was right. Okay, so this could be the case about some of these other people of the light, too. Perhaps at one point they were of the light and they've gone a different way. Persecution might not have been on their wish list, but they had a natural urge as leaders to expand their empire and power. Perhaps natural is an odd choice of words, but it does seem time and again that many of the elite succumb to greed and wage a war against those beneath. Such people have bowed, perhaps unwittingly, to the devil. Yep. And for those who don't believe in God and or the devil, let's just agree that these people are satisfying their own greed. A spinoff of this greed and hunger for power is not only persecution and oppression, but also a tarnishing of certain religions. In fact, true followers of these religions are not only tolerant of others, but go further than that. They love other people, even if those other people have different beliefs. See the interfaith cross. Jesus said, "Love thy Lord, thy God, with all your heart, all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is similar. Love your neighbor as yourself. Matthew 22:37-39. What an awesome responsibility for us all, especially our world leaders. But what an awesome license, privilege, and opportunity for us all to show the love of God. The Chi Rho cross is a warrior's cross, a cross like any other we could choose to follow Christ's example to wage war on any form of evil. And the surest thing to overcome evil, the only thing to overcome evil, is, of course, love. And I think that's a great place to end this. What I am going to do, though, is make a separate video that is a musical and reading, daily reading accompaniment to this one. Again, because of all those songs that I was given, and I think the climate is changing again, shifting in a good way, in a good way. But I'd like to go over that with you guys. So I'll be back. For now, namaste, angels.